Okay, welcome everybody on this second hybrid Folklore Society presidential address. We've got 14, 15 people in the room, but I should talk directly to the computer where the microphone is, and they will act as like the old Radio One days posse, who will laugh and whoop at everything I say, which is great support. Anyway, welcome. For the address, I should be talking for about 50 minutes. We don't have questions, I'm afraid, for the presidential address. So sorry about that. But hopefully I will be providing enough information and content and explaining things very clearly. So hopefully that won't be needed, but questions are always good. Sorry, can't answer them. So today, welcome. Everyone's mics is off, I can see, so that's great as well. So today I'm going to talk about the Witch of Endor in history and folklore. I am hardly the first person to talk about the Witch of Endor. There's been 2,000 years of 2,000 years of debate about the Witch of Endor, and I'll take you through a bit of that just as a background context, because what I want to focus on is, in a sense, the Witch of Endor, what you might call in the age of folklore and age of folklorists. In other words, broadly, 19th, early 20th century, because that's where not much work has been done. And there are some fascinating insights to be had by unpicking what the Witch of Endor meant to different sections of society through the 19th and early 20th century, and how it developed, changed, but also then how it draws upon, as I say, nearly 2,000 years of interpretations as well. So it's about continuity, it's also about change, it's about religion, it's about folklore, and it's also about folklorists and early folklorists as well, interconnected. And I'll end by looking at, in a sense, a change of perception about the Witch of Endor from spiritualism on through to sort of feminist interpretations of the Old Testament as well. So what this talk isn't about, just to make clear for those of you who might be disappointed, is, if it moves, this isn't about the moon of Endor, which I learn is where the Ewoks live, according to a 1985 telly film spin-off of Star Wars. So yeah, do Ewoks live on Endor, on the moon of Endor, not in the Endor I'm talking about? And I have no many, how many died at the Battle of Endor? I do not know. So yeah, no Ewoks, I'm afraid, here. So Endor, where is it? Let's just start by going, where is it? Well, we're not quite sure. Classic thing with Bible history, Old Testament history in particular, we're not quite sure. Here's a 1925 sort of guesstimation of where, obviously some can be identified, but this is a guesstimation of where Endor is. And you can just see it's considered to be around the bottom of what's called the Valley of Jezreel, which we know exists. So this is roughly where it is. Small town, we don't know really much about it. There's hardly reference at all in the Old Testament, and the Witch, I think, is one other reference to Endor in the whole Bible. So that's the context. That's what we talk about, not the moon of Endor. Okay. So I'm actually going to read from the Old Testament in a minute, which is probably the first time I've ever done that in public, just because I'm going to give you the story about what I'm talking about, the passage from 1 Samuel 28.
Pardon me, Dr. Davies. I'm so sorry to interrupt. The slides, for the people on chat, on Zoom, all we can see is the introductory slide, the Folklore Society, nothing else. Sorry to interrupt, but I thought
we get going. Thank you very much.
Because we were talking about how we can't see anything, and we definitely want to.
Okay. Do you want to have a quick fiddle there, Caroline?
Thank you.
No, thank you very much.
Do it from the beginning.
If the same person could just shout out and tell us if they can see it, that'd be great.
Okay. I'm hoping to see you all the way from Canada, so
stop the share.
No, somebody else has pointed out there appears only to be one slide on that.
Right, stop the share. Now start the share. If you click on the your own PowerPoint, there it is, that one. Right, not the top one, the bottom one. Now try running from the beginning.
Okay.
We're all right.
Can you
see?
Yes.
Ewoks.
Could we see
Matt?
Yeah.
Brilliant. Yes. Thank you very much for pointing out.
Perfect. Thank you very much.
There you are. It's the benefits of hybrid, the challenges of hybrid. Anyway, there we are. For those of you who weren't, well, I was nattering away. Here's where it is. One person has decided Endor is based on biblical commentary. As I was saying, there's very few references. I think there's only two references to Endor in the whole Old Testament here. So before I start reading what the Witch of Endor, the passage in which the Witch of Endor is described, I just want to say a bit about the context here. And so, as you'll see from when I read it out, this is about King Saul. And who is King Saul? King Saul is essentially the first, seen as the first, as usual, there is debate about whether he's a real figure or not. We're not getting into Old Testament biblical theory and history. But anyway, as told by the Bible, King Saul is essentially the first monarch of a united Israel. Okay, his reign is traditionally placed around the 11th century before Common Era. And it supposedly sort of marks a transition from Israel and Judah from a scattered tribal society to an organized statehood. And in the Old Testament story, his appointment as king is done by Samuel, the prophet Samuel. So it's the prophet Samuel who appoints him as king on behalf of, from a message from God. And as part of his reign in coalescing the various tribes, Israel tribes, he also institutes, this is relevant, he also institutes a ban across the kingdom against diviners and magicians on the pain of death. So all this is relevant when we come to the actual passage. Okay, so Saul has banished diviners and magicians from the land on pain of death. He has been, in a sense, appointed king by Samuel. Appointed king by Samuel. And so I shall now read the passage, which has, through 2,000 years, has attracted millions and millions of pages of debate and continues to do so. Every year, there's more debate about the Saul, the prophet, his ghost, and the witch or woman of Endor. We'll come to talk about the significance of why she's called a witch as part of the problematic way of unpicking how people thought about the woman or witch of Endor in the 19th century. So let me read out the passage from 1 Samuel chapter 28. Okay. And so, and when Saul saw the hosts of the Philistines, he was afraid, and his heart greatly trembled. And when Saul inquired of the Lord answered him not, neither by dreams, nor by Urim, nor by prophets. Urim and Thummim are two references, and again, massive debates about what Urim actually is, although one of the areas is thought to be two parts objects which are connected with the breastplate of a priesthood and to do with divination, but we'll go down there. Anyway, the Lord hasn't answered him to tell him what to do with confronting the war with the Philistines. Then said Saul unto his servants, seek me a woman that hath a familiar spirit, that I might go to her and inquire of her. And his servant said to him, behold, there is a woman that hath a familiar spirit at Endor. And Saul disguised himself and put on other raiment, and he went and two men with him, and they came to the woman by night. And he said, I pray thee, divine unto me by the familiar spirit, and bring me him up, whom I shall name unto thee. And the woman said unto him, behold, thou knowest what Saul hath done, i.e. in terms of banning diviners and necromancers, how he hath cut off those that have familiar spirits and the wizards out of the land. Wherefore then layest thou a snare for my life to cause me to die? And Saul swore to her by the Lord, saying, as the Lord liveth, there shall be no punishment happen to thee for this thing. Then said the woman, whom shall I bring up unto thee? And he said, bring me up Samuel. And when the woman saw Samuel, she cried with a loud voice. And the woman spake to Saul, saying, why hast thou deceived me? For thou art Saul. And the king said unto her, be not afraid, for what sawest thou? And the woman said unto Saul, I saw gods ascending out of the earth. And he said unto her, what form is he of? And she said, an old man cometh up. This becomes quite important, because why is Saul coming up from the ground and not coming down from heaven? It's one of the big debating points. There are a number here. And he is covered with a mantle. And Saul perceived that it was Samuel. And he stooped with his face to the ground and bowed himself. And Samuel said to Saul, why hast thou disquieted me to bring me up? And Saul answered, I am in sore distress, for the Philistines make war against me, and God is departed from me, and answers me no more, neither by prophets nor by dreams. Therefore I have called thee, that thou mayest make known unto me what I shall do. Then said Samuel, Wherefore then dost thou ask of me, seeing the Lord is departed from thee, and is becoming thine enemy? And the Lord hath done to him as he spake by me, for the Lord hath rent the kingdom out of thine hand, and given it to thy neighbour, even to David. That's the eventual successor to Saul, King David, who is his. I can't remember. Not his son, his nephew. Moreover, the Lord also deliver Israel with thee into the hands of the Philistines, and tomorrow shalt thou and thy sons be with me. The Lord also shall deliver the hosts of Israel into the hands of the Philistines. Then Saul fell straightway all along on the earth and was sore afraid because of the words of Samuel, and there was no strength in him, for he had eaten no bread all the day nor all the night. And the woman came unto Saul and saw that he was sore troubled, and said unto him, Behold, thine handmaid hath obeyed thy voice, and I have put my life in my hands, and have hearkened unto thy words, which thou spakest unto me. Now therefore, I pray thee, hearken thou also unto the voices of thine handmaid, and let me set a morsel of bread before thee, and eat, that thou mayest have strength when thou goest on thy way. The rest of the chapter is about him going out to battle, getting killed, his sons get killed, as has been prophesied by Samuel. Okay. And so there are a number of things in here which become debating points, because that's it, that's all there is on this story. And yet it's extremely important. One, to debate about spirits and ghosts. Two, to about the nature of necromancers, idea of witches and women. And three, the relationship between statehood and prophecy as well becomes a debating point here. So, and also that bit at the end there is important, because as we go through the centuries of debate, because she's, as we'll see, is such a negative character as portrayed right through most of history. But the very fact that despite Saul, in a sense, having, you know, banished such people as her a pain of death, she helps him out, she gives him food, she comforts him. And this becomes all part of the complex narrative about people trying to work out who is this woman. She's not referred to it. This passage is from the King James Bible. Okay, so I'm using that, obviously, because that's the main Bible in 19th century America and Britain, which is what I'm largely talking about in terms of my sources.
Dr. Davies, I'm very sorry to interrupt again. Yeah. We still see the map.
I'm just moving on slides. It's okay. There's one coming up. It's all right.
Okay. Terrific. Thank you.
I could have hundreds of slides about the Witch of Endor, the Woman of Endor. There are hundreds of them, but I shall spare you too many images. Okay. So, yes. So, this is the King James Bible. And as you'll see, as we'll come back to, she is not referred to as a witch in that. She is referred to as the woman with a familiar spirit. Okay, and we'll see where the idea that she's a witch comes from. That's kind of central to what I'm talking about. But in the King James Bible, which is still obviously one of the dominant Bibles today, she is referred to as a woman. There is no reference to a witch. So, some background context from antiquity through the witch trials. Sort of, this is very speedy. Again, there are hundreds of articles written about this, hundreds and hundreds. But I just want to give you a flavour of what the debate is. So, if we look at early rabbinic exegesis about the story of Endor, the early rabbis in their writings usually took it literally. Okay, it's accepted in most of the writings from that period, and we're talking right here in the first few centuries, Common Era, that Samuel's spirit, his ghost, did actually appear. In other words, that it was possible, it was actually possible for the souls of the dead, the spirits of the dead, to come and visit the living. Even though they basically considered the woman a wicked woman because Saul, under the word of God, had banished such people. So she's automatically considered a wicked woman, even though the debate then focuses on whether she really had powers to call up the spirit or not. And by association, other such necromancers. And diviners. Okay. But there is some small debate here. There's an unknown author called Pseudophilo, who's author of a text from around the second century CE, which is called Biblical Antiquities. And he's clear, Pseudophilo, that Samuel appeared, but that it was at God's command. So all these niceties come out over the next few centuries about this. Yes, it was his spirit, but it wasn't the woman who called it up. It's just kind of coincidence. That God commanded it at the same time that Saul, in a sense, was requesting him to appear this time. And there's back and forth a bit on this, but that is the central thing. Spirits could appear. Some say it's the woman, because most of the early rabbinic texts do believe that state there is such thing as magic, there is such a thing as in a sense of necromancy, whatever it is. But slightly shifts in what's called the Gaonic period, which is rabbinic texts mostly from Babylon, from around 6th century CE to 10th century CE. And there it starts shifting more towards the woman being a fraud. Okay. So these things are always shifting over time and long through time. If we look to the early Christian church fathers then, what about them? Well, this is where we start getting vast amounts of debate taking place here by the early church fathers here. Similar focus though, as the rabbinic text in essence. And the focus is very much upon Samuel's spirit rather than the woman and her powers. Okay, so the real nux of this is it possible for the spirits of the dead to come up? Is this story of Endor biblical truth that it happens and can happen? So that's reality, and that's become such a fundamental, obviously, Christian debate. This is why this story becomes so central to that, the issue between Saul and Samuel. And I say, then the issue was, because of the wording about Saul coming up, was Samuel in hell? And actually, some early Christian fathers said it's possible. It's possible the prophet could have been in hell. We don't know why, but it's possible. But the debate becomes quite diverse and fractured. There's three main camps. And I'll go through these three main camps because it very much sets in stone the kind of debates you get right through, even into the 20th century, essentially. Right through the witch trials, for example, when the Witch of Endor becomes this, in a sense, this archetype of the witch figure, or one of them. The same sort of debates cropping up ad nauseum. You know, there's only so much you can read of some of these debates, quite frankly. So, just to give you an example. So we have the likes of Origen of Alexandria, writing 185, 253, Common Era. And he reads 1 Samuel 28 literally. What he has before him is the word of God. Therefore, what is on the page is literally what actually happened. Therefore, Samuel's spirit did come up. It is quite likely, he says, that the woman could have called him up, but he's not sure. Possibly, it's a possibility, but can't actually say in this instance, it's not quite clear literally from the text what's going on. Then there are theologians who thought like Eustathius as a bishop of Antioch, and he's convinced that it's all demonic deception. The whole thing is a demonic deception. The appearance and the voice of Saul is to deceive both the woman and Saul. It's all demonic. And by, in a sense, even attempting to conjure up Saul, you're being blasphemous by doing it. So it's all demonic, it's all diabolic. Third position is kind of in between. Third path is to argue that the woman really did see and hear the likeness of Samuel, but it could still have been a demon in disguise. Everyone's hedging between all sorts of things here. So, as I say, the debate doesn't really shift greatly during the medieval period. But Charles Zeker, who's one of the fine historians of witchcraft in art, has done a really, really interesting survey of more later medieval illustrations of the woman of Endor. And identified, and here's an example here, if a stupid message keeps appearing. Decline and do not ask again. Yeah, that's the one. And this is a fairly typical representation of the whole event of 1 Samuel 28 and the Endor story. There are other ones which diverge a bit, but this is the standard one. And what's worthy of note, as Zeke points out here, in the way in which the story is understood and portrayed in medieval art, is the fact that the woman of Endor generally stands behind the king in all this art. That's the significance here. The emphasis in the medieval discourses and exegesis on this is about, again, the relationship between Saul and Samuel. And the woman is just a kind of this tertiary character, whether she's a fraud or not, whatever, you know, is the lesser question, lesser issue here. And at the back, there are just his two servants, the two servants who always seem to appear in this as well, with him as well. So that's a fairly standard representation. So when we move into the early modern period, and the witch trials, as you can imagine, as I said, the witch of Endor, woman of Endor, gets picked up as one of the key forms of defences. Here's the Bible talking about witches. Here's the Bible saying how these people were banished from the land in the first kingdom of the Jews. and look at other things like Exodus, thou shalt not suffer a witch to live. The Bible clearly tells us, the Bible clearly shows us that they do not, that the witches exist, that they should be dealt with and exterminated. And it's during the 16th century in particular that we start getting the language of witch being used. Ski mask on my face, I tell you gotta cheat, cause they had head in this bitch, aw, drank syrup like it's liquor. We have some interference, we have some musical accompaniment. Let the chopper bang on you like a blood or a cripple. So much bread, I'm a chimney, so much money, off the dummies, off the dummies. Yeah. We seem to be picking something up.
I was trying to work out how that fitted in with the Witch of Endor.
Yeah, no, I'm sure it does somewhere. It is a voice from the deep. Someone's called it up. It seems to have stopped. How spooky. Anyway, well, I wonder what we make of that. It seems to have stopped, yeah. It seems to have stopped, Caroline, yeah. So in the 16th century, this is when we start actually in vernacular Bibles. Across Europe, getting the term witch or its variants used instead of woman, and this is important. This is significant because this is all part of the affirmation of the probity and need for the witch trials themselves as instituted by secular authorities. But here the secular authorities can say, the Bible asks us, look at these figures there. And so, for example, the Geneva Bible of 1560 refers to a woman that had a familiar spirit, which is what King James copied from, but also refers to her as a witch, while the Luther Bible describes her as a woman who has a divining spirit, but Luther also refers to her as a Zauberin or sorceress, and later Luther Bibles often refer to her as a hexer as well through the 17th century. So the language is there, and if we look at the English Welsh Scottish context, of course, King James himself writes a book called Demonology, in which he has a discourse between two people in classical way. And the Witch of Endor is brought up there. For King James, the witch is, in a sense, the witch as the ones around them, the ones that he had only recently thought were responsible nearly for his death when he was bringing his bride over from Denmark. So he ties all this up. For him, the Witch of Endor is iniquitous. She's also a fraud at the same time. It's all the devil's work. And this is what these witches do, the conspiracy between witches and the devil. So this all fits into that whole discourse and framework which happens in the theology of around witches at this time. And in the same year that he institutes the creation of the King James Bible, which is 1604, is the same year that he tightens up the Witchcraft Act of 1563 at the same time. So you can see how this all kind of feeds in quite neatly, the biblical, the translation, the vernacular, the authorized Bible, even though it doesn't refer to witch, what we have as we then get commentaries on the King James Bible over the 17th century, you start seeing the commentaries bringing witch into the discussion as well. So even if the King James text doesn't translate as witch, but familiar spirit, the commentaries quite openly call her a witch at this time. You also get the term pythoness, used quite a lot in the 16th and 17th centuries. And this is another thing coming out of humanism, which is basically tying up the woman of Endor figure, the necromancer, with the pythoness, the priestess of the Oracle of Delphi. So they're linking this into classical antiquity and the idea of female representation of diviners and the python, the pythoness. And you see this quite a lot. People like Reginald Scott and his famous Sketch Discovery Witchcraft talks about the witch. Everyone's talking about the Witch of Endor. He considers her, he calls her a pythoness as well. Interesting because there's a back and forth, because King James obviously despises Reginald Scott. Reginald Scott doesn't have any truck with the way in which the likes of King James thinks. So for King James, it's demonic, whereas Reginald Scott takes the skeptical line. And this comes from looking at the Hebraic terms that were used for the woman, and one of them seems to equate with the idea of belly speaker or ventriloquist. So for him, the whole thing is illusory. The woman of Endor is using ventriloquism to project the supposed voice of Samuel. It's all illusion, all tricks. There's no devils involved, etc. So that's what you might call quite radical take at this time. Move to the end of the 17th century, the sort of decline of the witch trials into the early 18th century. We get the witch, now openly called the witch, which used all the time, the pamphlets calling her a witch. She gets used in the Restoration period as a representation of the Catholic Church. So she is the source and fount of all superstition, you know, and it's the blasphemous way in which people like Saul and modern day Sauls consult or engage with. So it becomes all part of that anti-Catholic rhetoric in the later 17th century at this time. And again, come into the early 18th century, and the Witch of Endor is still a significant figure because she is used again in another context to uphold miracles. This is a period in the early 18th century when the Church of England feels it's under threat. Deism, atheism are feared. Nonconformity is a growing force. And one branch of high church Anglicanism was to defend the reality of miracles and that miracles could still happen. Whereas the likes of deists argue that miracles were in the age of the Bible, they never happened since. So all these debates are happening. The Witch of Endor inevitably gets drawn into this debate as well. And if you deny that the Witch of Endor is a witch, if you deny that she's engaging with demons, you are in essence, denying the word of God, the word of Bible, and the reality of miracles. So she can see over these centuries how she gets pulled in different ways into different debates for different purposes and different reasons. So I'll just show you another aspect of what happens to the representations of hair, because that mirrors what I've been talking about from theology and the text, the way in which the witch is used as this figure in the witch trials, for the cause of the witch trials. And what you see in representations, particularly from the 1560s onwards, is a kind of conflation of the woman or witch of Endor with a ritual magician, which is normally a male figure in art. And Zika's worked on this a lot. Again, it's his interpretation, which I think he's absolutely right. And so you start getting his representation. This is a famous one. This is actually early 1526, one of the very earliest such representations of the witch of Endor in a conjuring circle with a book of magic in front of her. So what we get is this reimagining of what happened. Because none of that, from what I read out, we don't know what she did. There's no explanation. She just calls up Samuel. But here we start getting this whole framework of conjuration, necromancy, magic circles, magic books, imagining what she did. And here's another example from 15th century for a German Luther Bible. Again, a representation there. And as you see, you've got the ghost of Samuel, you've got the Witch of Endor within a magical circle, various consecrated items around it. So again, the idea of her as conjurer. If anyone's got their mic on, you just mute it. I think we had a bit of coughing in the background, thanks. Okay. So let's move on then to the 19th century and move into what we know from about popular belief. So we've got this whole long background of the witch trials, medieval period onwards. And then we come to material from the 19th century. And what did that all this mean? What did all this talk, all this debate about the Witch of Endor, the Woman of Endor, what did that mean to common people? What did 1 Samuel 28, how did that resonate with the general public? Now, we don't have much from folklorists themselves on this. When I come later to talk about folkloristics, we'll be talking about Bible history. We'll be talking about comparative mythology. That's what they're interested in. I'll come on to that. There's only few sporadic references to people expressing a belief in who or saying what the Witch of Endor is or what 1 Samuel 28 means to people. One of those is from the radical politician William Lovett, between 1800 and died in 1877. And William Lovett, in his memoirs, recalls returning to his hometown in Newlyn in Cornwall. And there's been a recent ghost scare, which has panicked the town. And he comes back, self-educated, self-taught, and he laughs. He laughs at this recent ghost scare in his old neighborhood. And when he's chatting with an old acquaintance who's a baker, the baker suddenly turns around and gets quite angry with him. And was really unhappy to hear this mockery about this ghost. And he upbraids Lovett and declares that he was clearly not, that Lovett was clearly not a believer in the Bible, and quoted to him directly the passage from Samuel 28. So it's quoting the calling up of the ghost of Samuel. So clearly, this is a passage which does stick in the minds of some and is brought up as a defense for ghosts in the 19th century. We do see other evidence of that as well. So that's an old debate. That old debate that we see going on in the 17th century is cropping up in popular discourse, folk discourse, in the 19th century. But the main, it would seem to be the main focus that people have out of the perception of it is to do with the witch rather than the ghost. It's a bit of a reversal of the old rabbinic. It's the witch which captures the imagination. It's her that is generally brought up as normally a defense of the belief in witches at a time when obviously they're being told by clergymen, educationalists, that it's foolish, it's stupid, it's ignorant to believe in this. So it's about them, and they do that with things like thou shalt not suffer a witch to live. So it becomes this arsenal of three or four quotes from the Bible, Leviticus, Exodus, and 1 Samuel 28. But how does this work? Where are they imbibing it from? You know, are they sitting there? There are lots of millions of people sitting there perusing their Bibles, you know, falteringly and focusing on, you know, these one or two passages. How are they getting to it? Well, the interesting things are happening with Bibles in the 19th century. And one of the key things, which I think is really important in a sense to the perpetuation of popular engagement with the Endor story, is illustrated Bibles. Illustrated Bibles become huge in the mid-19th century. Bestsellers, absolute bestsellers. And they brought some of the best engravers to produce scenes for these illustrated Bibles at this time. And I picked up evidence from elsewhere that particularly then later in the 19th century with the rise of evangelicalism, moving on from the early Methodists and primitive Methodists, a more diverse sort of group, that a lot of these societies would hand out illustrated Bibles because it's the illustrations that hook people into the Bible stories rather than actually reading it. And here's a really telling quote from Andrew Lang. Andrew Lang, one of the early presidents of the Folklore Society, as everyone should know in the room, Andrew Lang. And it's really interesting because he reflects on his own childhood and his own belief and understanding of the Witch of Endor story. And it preoccupies his mind. So in 1894, when he's writing this, he says, as a child, of all the Bible stories, none is more popular with children. And this is the important one, it's children. None is more popular with children than the tale of the Witch of Endor. On wet Sunday afternoons, the most admired plate in the Folio Bible is that which shows Saul falling forward on the earth and the witch woman shrinking back in astonishment and awe. And I think this is the one that he's referring to. I think it's Clark's Folio Bible, which he's probably depicting. There are other examples. I've got one a bit later, which is Gustave Doré does a very well-known engraving for another Folio Bible, which is one. But I think this is the one that Andrew Lang is referring to, Saul and the Witch of Endor. On here. And as you can see, depiction, and we'll come on to this in a minute, depiction again is very similar. They're drawing an inspiration from early modern art. You know, this is what they're drawing from Salvatore Rosa's famous painting, which I haven't got an image of here. And so all these engravings from the 19th century Folio Bibles are drawing upon the inspiration from early modern witch art of this period, famous examples. And how did this cement itself in his childhood? Well, Andrew Lang goes on really interestingly, and he says he recalls at the age of being 5 or 6, he grows up, he's in Selkirk, modest sort of middle-class family, Selkirk in Scotland. And he says as a child of about 5 or 6, he and the family gardener would often hammer away at this problem, the problem of the witch of Endor and the ghost of Endor. So we would hammer away with whether a witch or it was a witch and whether Samuel's spirit really appeared. And the young Lang would argue the Bible is true. The Bible says there is a witch and a ghost, therefore there are ghosts and witches. It's almost like going back to Pseudophilus, you know, nearly 2,000 years before, about biblical literalism. And then Lang would say, well, then the gardener might say there were witches, or at least there was a witch, but that was before the coming of the gospel. So now run away and see if you can find a ripe strawberry. Or again, Lang says, the answer would be Saul was a bad man, and therefore the devil was allowed to deceive him in the shape of Samuel. But it does not say anything about the devil, and the ghost's prophecy came true. Oh, no doubt that was permitted for wise reason, said the gardener. So now run away. So again, in the intractable interpretations here between a 6-year-old kid and obviously a quite well-read Gardner, I think, is quite telling about the ways in which. But also, that I say that idea that the I think the folio above is really important for re-injecting public excitement about Bible stories at this stage, because you'll see plenty of 19th century reference to people who don't read the Bible, don't want to read the Bible. The Bible is boring, and I'll come into some aspects of that as well. If we go through some of the sort of, you know, notes in the Folklore Society journal, we find that these people responding with, yes, but the Witch of Endor, is still there in the early 20th century as well. So a folklorist who was collecting around Berkshire in 1902 says that he said constantly justifying the existence of witches by reference to the story of the Witch of Endor. We know as there was such a thing, said people, because we read of them in the Bible. And then in 1920, as folklorist Mark Taylor, interviewing people about folk medicine and witchcraft in Norfolk, was told by one of his informants from Brandyston, who began one of his stories about local witchcraft with, well, we all know there are witches. It's in the Bible. There was the Witch of Endor. Well, when I was young, there was a man. His pony was taken ill. So it becomes this preface, you know, particularly when talking to people of authority. But if I'm going to talk about witches, I preface it first by saying and referring to the Witch of Endor. Now, on to our sort of next session here, because, of course, if they're all busy learning about 1 Samuel 28 from the King James Bible, there's no reference to her being a witch. So why is everyone referring to her as a witch? Why has it become so ingrained? None of these references anyone still refer to as a woman of Endor in the 19th century in a popular belief context. So this is where I think one aspect is probably in images like that, where the plate is introduced in the Bible as Saul and the witch. That's one thing. The other thing is the way in which the Witch of Endor is a popular topic for sermons in the 19th century. And I think sermons are an underused source for folklorists and also historians of popular culture. They are deadly dull often and tedious. Whether it's 17th century sermons or 19th century sermons, it doesn't really make that very familiar. But what I did then was go through lots of sermons about the Witch of Endor through the 19th century. And there are lots of sermons about the Witch of Endor in the 19th century. And I think these are important because if most people are not assiduously reading their Bibles in their homes. Right? They're not. Where they're getting quite a lot of stuff from, the doctor's looking at pictures, it's from having to go to church and listening to the clergyman, the minister, the preacher, talking about various stories from the Bible in various ways. So I've been going through all these, and I've broken it down to five categories of sermon and the ways in which the sermons engage with both popular belief through the Witch of Endor or sometimes through about ghost belief. So five broad categories. So here's the first one, and that's kind of hellfire damnation preacher. Nonconformist, okay, who likes to conjure up vivid images in their sermons. The sermons may not be about the Witch of Endor, but they will conjure up the Witch of Endor as something to excite the imaginations of their audience here. And a very good case of the eccentric but much in demand Yorkshire Methodist preacher William Dawson, who died in 1841, who had the very dramatic oratorial flourishes to grip the imaginations of his audience. And one particularly effective flourish was to point and look dramatically at the door of the chapel as if the biblical character he was invoking was about to appear. And everyone's stunned, I think. And he would do something similar when referring to the Witch of Endor. And I've got an account of somebody who witnesses preaching on this. This is a quote. His picturing took such a hold on the imagination that on exclaiming, stand by, there she is, some of the poor people inadvertently directed the eye downward, where his own eye was fixed on the ground, and the spot to which he was pointing, as if she were about to rise from beneath their feet and become visible to the congregation. So there's the Witch of Endor as a device, but one again, which comes back to how do you excite the imagination of not only of children but adults at this period. So that's one way in which she's used in sermons. So say not sometimes in ones which are about the Witch of Endor, sometimes he's just introduced character to make a point, normally about things like backsliding or superstition, things like that. Second type of sermon is kind of what I call the lazy minister preaching, which is kind of just retreading the same old Testament stories ad nauseum. And there's a humorous account of such sermonizing. In other words, it's a lazy trope. They know that people know the Witch of Endor. They know that people are interested in the Witch of Endor. So I'll just reel out the Witch of Endor story again as part of my sermon for this week. And there was a humorous account of this in about sermonizing in Presbyterian Ulster, where the commentator noted how some ministers had only a very small stock of sermons, and which would they would just kind of repeat them. And he gave a couple of anecdotes about this. And one anecdote concerns a man returning from Sunday chapel, who meets on the road an absentee from the congregation that day. "Well," asked the absentee, "what was our minister at today? Was he hanging Haman again?" And this is a reference to the Book of Esther and the story of Haman, who's an evil official who gets his comeuppance. So it's a classic Bible story. Should brought up. So he goes, "Is he hanging Haman again?" And this, and so this was a kind of, he's so bored. He's bored of hearing the same old story time and time again. And another example brings in the Witch of Endor in exactly the same context, and and also brings in the stinginess, the perceived stinginess of Ulster congregations towards jobbing preachers. And it's this jobbing preacher, and he goes, he's covering for a minister. And on returning home, the preacher's neighbour asks him about the subject of his sermon. He replies, "The Witch of Endor, that's what I was talking about." And the neighbour goes, "Well," said his friend, "and what did you make of the Witch of Endor?" "Oh, just the old six and eightpence," was the reply. "But they gave me a feed for my oats and my horse." So, you know, it's the idea, I'll trot it out, I'll give you that, and off we go. So, nice stories there. But it's not just me picking up on this one, because there's a Baptist minister called Frederick Charles of Darlington, who talks of this and criticises this type of sermon as interesting preaching. He calls it interesting preaching. "We all know it, and most of us have tried our hands at it. It's the sort of preaching," explained, "that may be done on a small stock of scholarship and a small stock of doctrine, bits of truth, bits of speculation. These are the staples of such preaching." And his examples of this are now the geographical position of the Garden of Eden, the Witch of Endor, the visit of the Queen of Sheba to Solomon, Jonah's gourd, and similar subjects. None of which, he says, are of any interest to anyone in the 19th century. But he's wrong, of course. He's wrong because the Witch of Endor clearly is, at least, of great interest to people. And so the third type of sermon is inspired by the present reading of the Bible. And this is where clergymen are, in a sense, reacting to the activities of cunning folk or witchcraft disputes in their communities, which they're really saddened about. They draw up a sermon because they want to kind of, you know, sometimes pontificate, sometimes criticize, you know, in a very passionate way, why they're wrong. They're wrong to go to the cunning folk. They're wrong to accuse people of witchcraft. And they will bring up the story of the witch like Endor and use it for that purpose, as these people are frauds. There's no such thing as witches. It's all superstition on this. And I'll just give, and you get this either side, you get this in the States pre-antebellum America as well, and you get it in this country. And the number of these sermons, which are based basically on the fact that someone has recently in a community, or a number of you have been to cunning folk or astrologers or whatever. I'll give you one example, which is from Norfolk, which is Reverend Richard Fair, who preaches a long sermon on the sinfulness of astrology in 1849 to as well, where he brings in the Witch of Endor. And essentially what's been happening, he's a magistrate as well, what's been happening is that an enterprising astrologer has been handing out flyers and handbills for his amazing services and using astrology for medicine. And lots of his parishioners have been taking this up and giving money to this character. He's a local magistrate, but he can't do anything about it because it's mail order. So he can't touch the guy. He's getting absolutely furious with this. So he preaches this sermon to his flock about the iniquities of astrology and the sorts of people and diviners. And so he brings up, you know, the Witch of Endor, this, and other biblical examples as well. But it's all about that idea of trying to get across to his flock that these biblical folks, the witch are there, is the same as these people in their own communities today. And that's the interesting thing, because it's about the relevance. This isn't, the Witch of Endor isn't just this biblical story. There are witches of Endor in your community here this time. And the fourth type is related to that, which is from 1848 onwards, which is the sermon against spiritualism and mediums, of which there are many as well. And what happens, of course, is that they use the Witch of Endor as an example of a biblical disapprobation of spiritualism. This can be argued in various ways. Sometimes it's argued that this is all demonic. This is a recrudescence of demonism, and that mediums are unknowingly, unwittingly, are conjuring up demons and devils, just as the Witch of Endor did. Okay. And here's an example of one of these anti-spiritualist Witch of Endor sermons and tracts here. You can see at the top there, it says Woman of Endor, Devil, Saul, and at the bottom, spiritualism, same scene, but this time, we have the medium, spirit, the ghost, and spiritualist. So all one and the same. So these are sermons which are critiquing spiritualism. And the final category of Endor sermon is about the defense of biblical literalism. Again, coming back to the same old themes and debates over centuries here. And this is the idea. These are debates. You get it particularly amongst American evangelists and their sermons. And this is the whole idea again, which the likes of Joseph Glanville were arguing in the 17th century, was that if you unpick and say that the story of the Witch of Endor, the Woman of Endor, is not real, you're trying to create all these other interpretations, then essentially you're unpicking and unraveling and undermining the whole Bible. It's an old, old argument, but it's being trotted out again and again, particularly in evangelical circles, through the 19th century with these Witch of Endor sermons. Oh, yeah. And just to give you an example, this is the Reverend William Croswell Duane, future bishop of the Episcopal Diocese of Albany. He tells his listeners that the description of Saul visiting the witch answers very well to the wicked farces of our day, the mystery, the darkness, the women's fear, the pretended visions seen only by the witch, the old man coming up the mantle. But who was it that spoke? Beyond a shadow of a doubt to my mind, it was the devil. And so you can see it's a classic one. The whole idea of the sermon is defense of the literal reading of the Bible. And in all of these five types of sermon, the representation is very much about the woman being old, ugly. Okay. In other words, it mirrors all those early modern representations. There's nothing in that passage in 1 Samuel which just describes her. So in other words, it's layering upon biblical literalism. Even those who are arguing for biblical literalism are adding spin to the story by saying that she's old, she's feeble, she's ugly, etc. She's a crone. And such are the nature of these sermons. I won't go into it in detail, but you can also, it crops up. The Endor sermon becomes a kind of novelistic trope during the 19th century. I've come across about six examples where the Witch of Endor sermon is used as some sort of device, novelistic device. I won't go into them, but one you do know, a lot of them are obscure novels you wouldn't want to read, a bit like the sermons. But Lorna Doone, Romance of Export, Lorna Doone has an Endor sermon as a device in there, for example. And I say there are other ones, more obscure ones. Okay. Let's move on to folklorists' interest in the zone. So why are early folklorists interested? They're not interested in this popular belief. That's not why they're interested in the Witch of Endor. What they're interested in, the people who are writing, the early folklorists who are writing about the Witch of Endor, who were writing about Samuel, or writing about 1 Samuel 28, are those who are into comparative mythology, comparative religion, and comparative folklore. And that they get in all sorts of tangled messes over this, because they're not quite sure what they're actually wanting to get. So in 1884, we have the English politician, one-time professor of statistics and economic science, James Edwin Thorold Rogers, died in 1890. He writes a book anonymously. He writes most of his stuff on religion anonymously, which is called Bible Folklore, A Study in Comparative Mythology. Now, he doesn't really focus much on Witch of Endor. He's mostly interested, though, in defending the Old Testament as a piece of real oral testimony. So in other words, you can read the Old Testament, and that is giving you, in a sense, an authentic voice about religion in antiquity. And then by comparing it with ancient Egypt and other places in comparative, you can then confirm that the Old Testament can be read as a historical document. Okay. So that's part of where they're coming from with this. So over and over again in this sort of literature, you get them using the Witch of Endor and saying, well, I think it's real. I think it happened. Right. In the Bible, it happened. It sounds familiar. We know from other cultures, ancient cultures, there were people like this woman or Witch of Endor, etc. Therefore, it must be real. Andrew Lang's actually contributes to this. He's much more critical. He's very critical of this because he basically says, hold on, this is a narrative. This is a narrative, right? Now, what we have in 1 Channel 28 is a narrator telling us about this. We don't know what Saul, the two servants, Samuel, and the witch Saul did, whatever. It's our narrator telling us. We don't, it's not primary oral testimony at all. And he, and Lang, of course, is, you know, someone who's at that very time he's writing about this is also saying that he's in disgrace with the Folklore Society for engaging with and being interested in psychical science at this period. So he's saying, we don't know about ghosts, for example. So we don't know about Samuel, if he's a ghost or not, because we're just currently in this great wave of scientific evidence. Let's not just assume that it's real, just as we shouldn't assume that it's not real. Okay. Now, Fraser, famous Fraser, Golden Dawn, inevitably has quite a lot to say. He has a whole chapter on the Witch of Endor, and it's absolute nonsense. You know, if Andrew Lang was around, Andrew Lang was a great critic of Fraser. And if Lang died before Fraser's book on Bible folklore came out, but you can imagine he would have had a field day with it. Because basically Fraser, he goes back to calling her a witch. Right? Like the likes of Lang and Huxley start using the term wise woman, which was putting in context in a contemporary context was interesting, so right, which sort of talking about. Fraser just goes back, yeah, let's call her a witch again. Yeah. Doesn't reflect upon it at all in terms of that whole history of terminology. And it basically turns the whole story of Saul's visit into a full-on adventure story. It's really quite remarkable. He talks about watchfires twinkling in the darkness as they made their way to Endor. Music drifted in from the enemy camp. And arriving at Endor, Saul taps quietly at the cottage door. On entering, they behold the witch. She may have been young and fair, with raven locks and lustrous eyes, or she may have been a wizened, toothless hag, with meeting nose and chin, blear eyes and grizzled hair, bent double with age and infirmity. We cannot tell. And the king was doubtless too preoccupied to pay much attention to himself. So that's the level of Fraser's scholarship on the Witch of Endor. And basically, he just uses the story, compares it with the Maori, the Tuareg, sub-Saharan African tribes, to talk about necromantic practice in antiquity. It's just another example. Margaret Murray does something similar. Another president of the Folklore Society does something similar in her presidential address from 1955. Where she brings up the Witch of Endor as being reality, a real historical episode. And for her, she's not so much interested in what Fraser's, but similar in the sense that she's trying to find divination rituals of ancient Egypt, modern North Africa, and seeing how it fits in. So she's trying to say, what was it the witch did? That's what she's interested in. What is the ritual the witch did? We don't know, because it's not in the Bible, so she goes all around the world looking for examples of possibly the Witch of Endor could have done. Okay, nearly there. And I'm just going to end by giving a more positive spin, because from spiritualism onwards, the Witch of Endor actually starts getting a makeover. And it's frozen, my images are frozen, so you won't be able to see them. There we go. Anyway, a positive view emerges, just to end on, a positive view emerges. For spiritualists, she's an absolute role model, first medium. And indeed, from 1850s onwards, and even in modern sort of literature from rabbinical literature, she's now called as a medium. She's often called a medium. So there's a shift in terminology thanks to spiritualism here. The term witch is essentially banished from spiritualist discourse. She's the woman or even the lady of Endor, a seer, a prophetess, the mother of all mediums. And you get loads of sort of encomiums to her. James Martin Peebles, for example, clairvoyant and physician, says the clairvoyant of Endor was a woman, benevolent, generous, forgiving, even by the feeding of her enemy. He went on, only a pulpit Pecksniff, mad with prejudice and accustomed to Billingsgate, would apply to her such epithets as these vile witch, a wretched outcast, idolater, outlaw, a lonely hag, wretched medium, haggard, godless, bandit, and the lot. You know. So the spiritualists are trying to overturn this and have some success in terms of representations. And I had a few, but I can't turn the image, so it doesn't matter. And another female medium, American, really elevates her into almost like a goddess figure for her. This is Elizabeth Oak Smith, who died in 1893. In 1852, she adopts the Witch of Endor as her role model. Okay? The women of Endor, This is a strange perversion of taste that would represent her hideous in aspect. To me, she seemeth all that is genial and lovely in womanhood. The braids of her dark hair mingled with the folds of her turban, her oriental robes spread beneath her, the rich girdle, and the bust swells with her impassioned appeal. I behold the proud contour of her features, the deep spiritual eye, the chiseled nostril, and the lip-shaming rubies. So you get this very... But the interesting thing, there is a lasting, I think, influence of that. And it, when you look at some representations of her today, particularly in children's tales of Bible, she's actually quite attractive. So there has been this influence. And it wasn't just the spiritualists. The Church of Latter-day Saints, early on, also considered her a prophetess. And even in Church of Latter-day Saints folklore from the 1860s, 1870s, it went round that she was Saul's wife. Samuel's wife, which is not in the Bible at all, but it becomes part of there briefly. But anyway, some of the early founders basically say, I think she's a prophetess. I think we should give her the benefit of the doubt. There may be some doubt, but we don't know. And Hiram Smith, who basically takes over from Joseph Smith as kind of leader of the movement, in an now lost sermon, says, this woman, instead of being filled with the devil, was one who had the power of God, the holy priesthood, to call forth the dead. In other words, she is a benign figure, an important figure, a prophetess, which was slowly eroded because then the Church of Latter-day Saints were trying to distance themselves from tax, equating them with spiritualists. So, but there we are. I shall end there on a positive note for the Witch of Endor and wonder, where does she go next? She is still current and resonant in contemporary society, not for as many people as they were in the 19th century or before, but she's still a talking point, she's still an academic talking point, she's still someone who more recent feminist Old Testament scholars are all now putting a more positive spin on her, describing it in new ways through feminist theory as well. So I shall end there. Thank you very much. Stop recording.
Thank you, Dr. Davies.
Thank you very much.
Good lecture.
The hands up in the kitchen as well. So we're all good. We're equally unanimous. There he is. There's Jeremy in the kitchen with his hand up as he comes into the room. So that's all unanimous. And just once again to thank Bill.
Can you just press got it then, please?
Got it. We've got it.
Yes.
Thanks. And just to say thanks to Bill, minuting his last set of minutes, which have been done brilliantly. And obviously to welcome.
I enjoyed most of it.
Can we formally minute the thanks to Bill for all his stunning work in there.
Stirling work.
Thanks for recorded. Thank you very much, Bill. Yeah. Couldn't have done it without you.
Indeed,
it's true. You've had some of the sucker. Sorry.
This is any other business, which is our proposal of our enormous thanks and gratitude to Bill.
At least we thank you with a cup.
Do you get it and I explain it?
Yeah, you get it now.
All right. Okay. Are we doing this within the meeting?
Yes.
Any other ones to watch?
Oh, excellent. It probably makes sense within the meeting.
Yeah, okay. Hand over to you.
As a mark of our extreme gratitude, not only to everything you've done for us as secretary, but also to your cultural role. I remember that excellent meeting we had in Cardiff. I remember some of the work you've done on world traditions when we were, doing the Folklore of War conference. We have brought you a little something which is making its way even as we speak out of the kitchen.
Well, the original design
looks like this.
This is what you were supposed to have.
Yes.
I think you better sit down.
Yeah, I think that's right.
That's the cake design with the dragon on the top.
Bill, the intentions were good.
Hold it up in front of the stand. Hold it up for the audience.
After reading Owen and Davies on the Oath by Heresy.
For those that can't see, a cake was ordered with a Welsh dragon on West. A beer barrel. A Kilburn cake maker.
I'm familiar with the international aspects of this.
Into the following. If you can see this, it's extraordinary.
It's also a tribute to the Folklore Society's
cosmopolitan. I think you have to stand up and switch the camera. No, that's just a problem. Switch the camera.
Yeah, let me do it. That's enough, I think. It's a cobra on top of a bat. Basically,
anybody from Cardiff, given something with what might be a hammer dryer on it, would be very offended, because that is the local STI hospital in Cardiff.
Not only have we got the wrong thing, he's never going to talk about it.
I don't know how they got from dragon to cobra.
It was a cultural misunderstanding.
Cultural misunderstanding. A topic of folklorists.
However, if by any chance, let's get a knife.
Can
I feel that the cake is might save the
day.
Knife and some cake.
Anyway, I think that wraps up in rather wonderful style this annual general meeting. If anyone's got any last things for any other business, I'm just quickly checking through. Hopefully, everyone's just talking about Welsh cobras. The chat function has
but given that up. It does mean that this is a business meeting.
Yeah.
There's actually, she says, a voice from Wales, a very famous story about the Nidir, about the Welsh viper. And the little flying dragon.
Yes.
So I'm afraid they haven't gone as wrong as you think they have.
Except it's not a viper.
Neither was the character in the story. It had wings. I think that was the closest they could get with the Welsh word. Gellith will bear me out on that.
So Finu says, what does it taste of? Hopefully not cobra.
Anyway.
He says it's all edible except there's a kebab stick out the middle of the
I think you can take the cobra home if you build it.
Yeah.
Perhaps you should set the cobra onto a plate for safekeeping. Set a plate. Where the sticks?
Where's the kebab stick? Yeah.
Yeah. Now you can put that in front of the camera, see if they can really see it.
Well, the camera, if you shift the...
There, perfect.
Oh, yeah.
Perfect. Yes. Owen, hold it in front of your face.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
There's the cobra. There's the Welsh cobra.
Look, Kate, can you see it now?
Yes. That was meant to be a dragon. But there you go. Anyway, I think it's time. It's 7:27. And as Tina says, just wow, I think it's probably good. A good way to finish it. Thank you, everyone who's there virtually. Thank you, everyone who's in the room for the annual general meeting. It's always been a pleasure, as usual. Hope you enjoyed the talk. I look forward to seeing you some again at my final AGM as president sometime in the year. So thank you very much. I'm going to turn off the video shortly. Have a good evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye.
I'll take this cake home with me, so it has to be some of it, though.
You just have to eat.
Bye.
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 See you all.
Hey, Paul.
Bye. Get better, Paul.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Get well soon.
Thank you.
Get better soon.